They wing their way to gunnery practice, and you'll see how skillful the sky shooting is. A sleeve target is released and towed near Galveston, Texas. There to swoop down on that. Peeling off. In disciplined maneuver, the planes of the squadron swoop down on the target as it's towed along. A mark for bursts of machine gun fire. Like long-experienced veterans of the Army Air Corps, yet they're Tensaw National Guard aviators in training. They've learned the acrobatic art of air battle, how to shoot down a hostile warplane.
Wendell Wilkie is special guest for the dedication of the great new Vultee aircraft plant at Nashville, first to be built within the inland defense zone. The huge structure contains 18 acres of floor space and will turn out scout planes for Uncle Sam and dive bombers for Britain. On a 24-hour day, 7-day week schedule, the president's latest request, what a bunch of planes they'll be able to turn out here.
They say this tower makes parachute training less frightening than just jumping out of a plane. But we wouldn't know. Just offhand, it doesn't look very soothing. Steelworkers are putting the finishing touches on this training device for the parachute battalion at Fort Benning, Georgia. They don't mind, but they're funny that way. You crawl out to the edge. And when you let go, the parachute opens, like this, and lets you down nice and easy, like that.
More bombers for Britain. With the president's plea spurring the aviation industry, the Lockheed plant goes all out in production of Hudson bombers for the RAF. Wings the British Lion once and is getting special delivery. While aiding England's airmen, Uncle Sam's not forgetting his own. The Army gets a lightning interceptor. Powered by liquid-cooled motors, the ship can take off in a flash to intercept enemy bombers. A flying arsenal with machine guns and cannon in its nose. World's fastest warplane. It speeds 7 miles a minute.
America's speed demon, so fast that ordinary man can't fly it without chemical help. Test pilot Milo Burcham dons an oxygen mask. For 30 minutes, he'll breathe deep and ride a bicycle, cramming his system with oxygen to prevent blackouts when flying at 500 miles an hour plus. A special air pressure helmet and a flight oxygen mask. And it's all aboard the P-38 Interceptor, the world's fastest plane. Twin propellers turning in opposite directions, the heavily armed P-38 cruises around 400. Opened up, well. America sees another new marvel of aviation, the Sikorsky helicopter. The takeoff, 90 degrees straight up. This experimental model, a veteran of hundreds of test flights, goes aloft to attempt to break the world's endurance record for flight over one spot. Vertical flight. Since 400 BC, man has tried to build helicopters. This American invention came out in the 1920s, did not rise. This windmill plane was another product of a decade ago. Freaks, people called them, laughed at them, and air-minded dreamers went ahead building, scheming and failing. But each time, aviation learned something new, something important. These flapping flops of yesterday each played a part in today's great triumphs of aviation, though more than faith took a shaking. And hovering in a May 1941 sky, Igor Sikorsky and his helicopter proved that vertical flight has arrived. U.S. military observers see important uses for this craft that, supported only by its main rotor's downdraft, notice the blown grass, utilizes three-tailed propellers for control of flight forward, sideways, backwards, or in circles. Sikorsky has at last achieved in a machine the hummingbird's flight, the poised suspension in the air of the little bird that started Leonardo da Vinci drawing helicopter plans 500 years ago. 1 hour and 32 and a half minutes of flight in suspension, a new world's record. Able to land within 18 inches of any given spot, the helicopter may open a vast new field of air tactics to American airmen who won't believe the phrase, "There ain't no such bird."
Air power in the brilliant skies of California. Flying fortresses of the Army, 22-ton monsters, each of which carries a bomb load of 2,500 pounds. Each is driven by 5,000 horsepower and has a radius of 3,500 miles. Formidable figures expressing power in a glowing sky. The squadron flies over clouds and over towering peaks. The clouds open and we see San Jacinto Mountain. Flying fortresses visit that lofty citadel of the Sierras.
One of the Army's deadliest fighter planes, the Curtiss P-40, loads up for a ground firing test. When the pilot presses the trigger, six machine guns bark as one. Two 50 caliber guns in the nose, shooting right between the whirling propeller blades. Every burst converges on the mark. The last word in synchronized firing.
At Wright Field in Dayton, Ohio, the Army's new portable laboratory puts photo processing on a blitz basis. This observation plane has just taken pictures of enemy concentrations, and over they go. The films float down and are rushed to the lab and into the dark room. In a matter of minutes, prints are ready and start on their way to the division commander. Use of this portable processing equipment means that finished aerial photographs of targets are quickly available to advance headquarters.
After 5 years, the biggest bomber ever built, the Douglas B-19, gets set for its trials. With a wingspan equal to the height of a 20-story building and wheels that dwarf the tallest man, this 80-ton giant is capable of flying to mid-Europe and back with 18 tons of bombs. A $2 million sky battleship that makes all other bombers look like toys.
New Yorkers get a look at a transport plane that may become one of Uncle Sam's most potent military weapons. The Curtiss Wright Transport, largest twin-engine plane in the country, is equipped to carry 36 passengers. But stripped for war service, it could carry 50 armed soldiers 1,500 miles. The Air Corps has 300 giants like these on order, a fleet capable of transporting 15,000 troops across the continent overnight.
Class in aviation is given theoretical instruction in the art of flying, and eager pupils they are. They go to get their diplomas at the Southwest Airways Thunderbird Fields. They're graduates of Arizona's first school for training pilots. This is done under a private contract with the United States Army. Full-fledged birdmen now, ready to do their bit in the service of the sky.
After their 2,400-mile trip from the United States, 21 of the Army's flying fortresses line up for inspection at Hickam Field, Hawaii, one of the world's largest air bases. The huge Boeing B-17Ds are of the latest type, fifth of the flying fortress model. Their flight from San Francisco took only 13 hours and 59 minutes. Their Their presence here points up the importance that Washington attaches to maintaining United States power in the Pacific.
New training equipment at Fort Benning, Georgia. Parachute pupils are drawn to the top of a tower 250 feet high. The first training operation is that kind of descent. They get used to a parachute. Easy way first. The second operation, the pupil is in a position such as in actual jumping, and he gets accustomed to the jerk when a parachute opens. Then practicing how to land, important for a parachute soldier. And finally, they're launched for a descent on their own. Troops from the sky acquire new importance in modern war, and the Army is training them in an up-to-date way. He makes a perfect landing, and now is ready to try it from a plane in the sky.